Hey, everybody, welcome to our Dynamics Virtual Summit. My name is Andrew King, Managing Director here at WebSan, and we are thrilled to have you for our second annual virtual summit. We maxed out our attendance, so I can't be happier about that. I think we have about 150 people attending today and just thrilled to have all of you join us. We're also going to welcome a special guest from Microsoft to talk about really the ecosystem today, where Business Central fits into that. Again, just terribly excited to have him. We'll introduce him here shortly. For those of you not aware, a little bit about us. We are a Gold Dynamics partner out of Toronto, Canada, with offices also in the US. We were Microsoft's Global Partner of the Year last year, as well as a Canadian Impact Award winner and an Inner Circle member. So we're incredibly proud of that. We specialize really in Dynamics 365 Business Central, which is the core ERP solution for small to medium-sized businesses. And we surround that with Dynamics 365 Sales, CRM, Customer Service, also Microsoft 365 and Azure, and really also specialize in really vertical industry solutions for small to medium-sized businesses. If you haven't been on our YouTube channel, and quite frankly, what we find is most of our clients have and most of our prospective clients have, we just, I think we're around 8,700 subscribers and almost 1.8 million views. So all the videos from today and all the sessions from today will be on our YouTube channel in the coming weeks. Encourage you to take a look there for other additionally great content. So this is it. I'm so excited. We're here. It's our second annual user conference. We're going to share content that's hopefully very relevant to you. It's based on feedback we've gotten from clients, customers, existing, et cetera, over the years, over the past year in particular. And again, just so excited to have you guys here. With that being said, it is my pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker today. Sherief Ibrahim has been a massive supporter of WebSan over the years. We met a few years back, and I call him a friend. He is the General Manager of Business Applications here at Microsoft Canada. Sherief, thank you so much for joining us today. If you wouldn't mind, just give the audience a little bit of background about yourself and your role here at Microsoft.
Well, first off, thanks again for having me, Andrew. And I do very, very well remember when we first met, and love the friendship that we've been building here. I've actually been at Microsoft now for about 10 years. I've worked in the industry for over 20 years, a variety of different roles, category management, lifecycle support, business management, et cetera. And at Microsoft specifically, I helped actually first build the Surface franchise in the consumer space. I worked in modern work on Windows and devices. And over the last roughly year and a half, worked in biz apps and industry cloud. So lots of different experiences working across, you know, sales, marketing, supply chain, et cetera, within technology.
Yeah, for sure. Excellent. Excellent. All right. So let's dive into it. First area we want to really talk about is really that business applications ecosphere, if you will.
Yes.
You know, Business Central combined with Power Apps and Azure. I mean, can you talk to kind of where Microsoft is investing in this entire ecosphere as it relates to Business Central?
Yeah, absolutely. So Business Central is something that we've built and specifically designed for SMBs, right? It's all about creating a one-stop shop or an all-in-one application that brings them a lot of functionality across their entire business. But I think it's important just to note, how does it connect to the broader Microsoft cloud? Because it's not just Business Central. Ultimately, Business Central is built on everything you see here on the screen. Right, starting first with, you know, our world-class identity, security, management, and compliance. You've got over 3,500 cybersecurity experts on a regular basis working on making sure we have a very secure platform. You've got thousands of Azure services backing this product as well. It's a massive investment in business for us. We continue to go and expand our data center presence and some of the investments that we're making there across the globe. And then you look at even the functionality and the tools that you can build with and build on top of this, you know, Visual Studio and GitHub for the pro developers, and then low code. So think Power Applications, you know, VirtualBox, Power BI. And then what I think a lot of this audience is probably familiar with is, you know, think about Microsoft 365. We live and breathe in things like Teams and Outlook, Excel. Gosh, how much time do we spend in Excel when we're running a business? And so how do all of these different pieces from the security, identity, the services from a cloud perspective, so think machine learning, artificial intelligence, right up through to the productivity tools, how do they all connect with Business Central so that ultimately a small, medium business can use the product to run various parts of their business, but get some of the strength and capability that an enterprise would get from some of these other services here.
Yeah. And that's what we're seeing. We're seeing such a powerful tool set being added to the periphery around Business Central that it really, really accelerates SMB adoption of the product. And to your point, working in workloads that people are already familiar with, like Exchange, Office, et cetera. So it's really good stuff.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, you know, just to give a little bit more color too around like what is actually Business Central itself. And so, you know, you see here kind of six modular different applications that really make up Business Central. Things from, you know, running your P&L and finance, sales, customer service, supply chain. And what's really critical is what's in the middle here is how we bring data from a variety of different places into that one experience. And so you can actually really run your business around these different modules all in one place. The other great thing is it's very extensible. I think we've done a lot of work with you in particular on that extensibility. So we offer something that out of the box is a lot of great functionality, but then someone like yourself, Andrew, and some of your amazing team is able to add a lot of really great value around that, that I want to make sure we do talk about at some point in the discussion today. But you get a sense for this really being a one-stop shop, if you will. And it's got a lot of great capabilities, even from its earlier days, from its on-premise days, you know, coming right into the innovation we're making to optimize it for the cloud.
Yeah. And one of the other sessions that's happening today is that there's a firm out of Australia that we've partnered with that's created just hundreds and hundreds of gorgeous Power BI reports that come right out of the box and fully integrated to Business Central. And we've seen clients adopt that quite readily. And you know, they don't have to wait for us to build out custom reports and things like that. They get access to that information right out of the gate. And that's been a huge, huge benefit to small to medium-sized businesses for sure.
100%. I think that's where when you start to really consider the value of moving to the cloud and some of the benefits you're going to get, it's going to be that rapid ability to go and take advantage of some of those templates, things that have already been built, not to mention the continual you know, innovations that we're adding to the product, which maybe I'll just talk about a couple of examples of that right now. So, you know, I think one of the things we're seeing from customers is they're starting to move more and more to the cloud offering of Business Central. Like one of the things we hear is, we want to make sure that we're getting to something that's secure, that we can really trust and have confidence to put our information into, but also we want to be able to do that on the go. And those two things go hand in hand. If you're going to be able to have a more mobile experience, whether you're running your business on a tablet, you're out on the go, you're in a drive meeting a customer, having the ability to take your business everywhere, but do that securely becomes incredibly important. And so that's why that investment in security at the core is really critical, but also the investment in the UI and what we're doing from a mobile perspective is really awesome. I think the other thing though, just back to what we talked about around, let's be where people are spending their time. Like, you know, when I would work in the supply chain side of things, working with hardware, I mean, we spent a lot of time in Excel. And, you know, having to go back and forth between your system of record and back and forth with multiple Excel spreadsheets, it's incredibly cumbersome and time consuming. And so one of the things that we've done in the last little while and we're going to continue to innovate on is how do you create these natural connections where you're already in Excel, but it can actually pull information right from Business Central. And so imagine you're working on a spreadsheet with a list of POs, and the spreadsheet's smart enough to know that when you pull that PO in, it's going to pull all the corresponding information in from Business Central. And so for that PO, who's the vendor, what's the amount owed potentially, you know, all the different kind of things you can imagine you want to bring in. And as you're updating that spreadsheet, it's real-time updating it back into Business Central. So we're really creating a good two-way connection between the two. And you just think of the productivity gains somebody would get by having those types of connections. And then how can a partner like yourself really help us, and you are today, create even more kind of capabilities around those features?
Yeah, we've seen more and more clients, to your point, people live in Excel all the time. The traditional approach is to export a bunch of stuff, manipulate it, and then try to figure out a way to get it back in or manually update it, right? And having this capability, even when you extend it or out into supply chain, like you said, purchase orders are a great example, forecasting, things like that. You know, people love to live in Excel. So the connection that Microsoft's created between Excel and back to Business Central is obviously key in that. So that's been a big win for sure.
Yeah, and I think, you know, we're trying to make this real in a bunch of other places. Like, I love the example here with Outlook. And for those who are using Outlook today, you can kind of almost compare this to, you know, you might get those daily digests that come into your inbox that say, hey, you know, Andrew emailed you about this great event coming up. You didn't respond to him yet. There's that AI built in to kind of remind you that maybe it's time to respond to Andrew. And that's actually a real scenario, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
But here's an example where it's intelligent enough to know that when it sees that email from you, it knows that, hey, you're actually in our CRM database. You're in Business Central. And so it's going to pull up to the side here a lot of relevant information about you right where I'm working an email. You know, past orders, trends that we have with you. I can actually go and update our system of record through the email as well. I mean, a great workflow example that we use here, for example, when something comes in for approval, instead of having to click a link, jump into a website, fill in the information, you can actually embed all that into the email. And so you think of that workflow and just being that much more fast to get things done and not have to jump around. Another great example where we can start to really bring things together through the power of our cloud.
Yeah, we had a client use case where customer service would get an email from a customer asking about, you know, is their order on time, is it getting delivered? And Outlook was able to reconcile the customer email address with the customer record in Business Central. And right there in Outlook, they're able to answer the email without ever logging into another system or even going to another browser. So there's some incredible stuff being done here for sure.
Yeah, you think about the time, we've done studies to help quantify what those savings look like, but you can just start to imagine how much faster and more efficient, and at a time when you need to be able to do more with less, those types of innovations start to really matter and add up over time. Another great example, as you're mentioning inventory, a good one, you know, Teams. We know we're spending a lot of time in Teams every day. We talk to customers, especially with the ability to be truly hybrid. We've got to enable Teams to be able to work in platforms like this. And so here's another great example where, you know, as we're working on something together, I can type in a part number and it can actually bring up information from our system on that part. It can bring in inventory information. It can bring in a spec sheet, for example. Like, it can start to connect back to our system of record or to Business Central and pull those things in. And conversely, you could be in Business Central and actually use Teams within Business Central as well. So we're creating that two-way connection again. And so you can start to get an idea of like all the different things that you can start to do when these systems speak to each other. And, you know, when we think of where we're investing a lot of our R&D and time, it's how are we taking all the different data from these different systems? How are we taking artificial intelligence? And how are we better predicting and serving information in the places you already are, so you can be that much more productive and not have to context switch and really stay in the flow of your work?
Yeah, and the other thing that Microsoft is doing is it's making this data visible, in particular inside Teams, without even requiring necessarily a full Business Central license to do so, right?
That's right.
And I just got back a bit still jet-lagged from Germany at Directions EMEA and then out at the Partner Advisory Council. And that was a big part of the conversations we were having, is how to surface information that's important to organizations, but not necessarily try to exacerbate their license fees through the roof either. So being able to embed and access information that's in Dynamics from Teams without having to purchase a separate license is just a game changer.
Absolutely. We've got to make it easier for people to take advantage of all these different investments and just, again, be in the flow of where they're working. So, you can imagine a variety of scenarios. Like, what you're looking at here is what we would call a card within Teams. It's important because as you look at some of our roadmap, these types of cards and really bringing to life the stuff that we have in our systems of record, like a Business Central, into Teams, and making that real. It could be customer information. It could be, you know, if we're working on a deal together for a particular customer, imagine I type in that customer name and all their customer record of information comes up. I can update the deal right there instead of having to go back into my sales module and update the information there. I mean, for a seller, that's massive. That's massive. Not to mention there's a variety of other things you can do there with note taking and dictation, et cetera. It's pretty cool.
Yeah. And in fact, that was one of the other use cases we saw that people were just amazed by is, you know, you're on a customer service call with a client and, you're on a Teams call and it's actually taking transcription. And then that's actually embedded in the Dynamics case in the customer service module of Dynamics 365. So, I mean, there's just some amazing things you guys are doing with combining all these things. And even at Directions, one of the key themes was obviously do more with less, right? But where Microsoft really wins is combining or leveraging its ecosystem, right? So if you're in Business Central, you can see that information in Teams, it's in Outlook, you can be in Outlook and see that information there. You've got customer service and sales being surfaced in these various platforms. So it's how all this stuff works together that's really how we pitch the value proposition to our customers for sure.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think to your point on doing more with less, maybe I'll talk a little bit about the Power Platform. I think, at a time when we are all being asked to do more with less, I mean, here's a great example where there's a variety of different modular solutions that customers can take advantage of this. Like right now, you know, we continue to hear and we talk to our customers, data is the currency, data is the next gold. Like it's ever, but it's how do you take that data? How do you reason over that data? And how do you start to make better decisions over that data? And there's a lot of things that Business Central out of the box can do there. The idea with Power Platform and low code though is, you know, if you kind of go back in time a little bit and think about what a step change it was when Excel came out, and the ability now for a person to have this intelligent spreadsheet to be able to do some fairly, you know, what feels like today, very basic kind of equations and doing things like pivot tables. Like imagine when that came out, to be able to be an individual person with that kind of power in front of you was pretty incredible. Even think about PowerPoint and not having to be a graphic designer, but suddenly you could become a graphic designer. Well, you know, look at the visualization of data here. And you talked a little bit about that earlier with the example for Australia. How do we make it easier for people to take data and suddenly realize, hey, there's a trend or pattern here with this type of customer and what they're purchasing? We're seeing that there's this problem over here from an inventory perspective. You know, when we look at this segment of the market, it's clearly a gap. Like, how do we make it easier for people to visualize data? And of course, pull data from different places, not just from your own systems, but even third-party information that's out there in the marketplace. So that's what Power BI does. And I think a lot of people are familiar or have heard of Power BI. I think what we're seeing a lot of energy and excitement, though, is in these other three areas, Power Apps, Power Automate, and Power Virtual Agents. You know, we were talking with one of our research firms, and they have an estimate right now that 50 million applications have to get produced over the next 5 years. I think you probably heard this at some of the talks that we've been at. And there just isn't enough developers on the planet to kind of keep up with that. And so our ability to make it easier for someone that's not technical to have an ability to either build basic applications or I think really create automations is key. And let me be specific in what I mean here. You know, every SMB who's listening to this has some type of a process or you know, for everything that they do, whether it's documented or undocumented, whether it's, you know, think about, you know, open the spreadsheet, take information from here, put it over there, email it to this person over here. They're then going to input that into a system. Think of that process. Now, think if you could start to automate that process and create automatic connections. And, you know, for many customers, that becomes a very viable way to suddenly go and save time and money. And we're seeing customers not in IT, like people in the finance department, people in the marketing department, take advantage of those capabilities. And I think what's brilliant is, you know, I look at someone like yourself, Andrew, and the things that you've put together to help SMBs, you know, what can you do with this? Like being able to create automation templates so that whether it's, you know, intelligent forecasting or stock replenishment, like you can build automation templates for people that they can just take up and start to use and get value out of almost immediately.
Yeah, absolutely. We did a webinar actually last month on that subject with Power Automate specifically. And it was around one of the use cases was, you know, a critical item reaches a particular inventory level, you can alert people, or, you know, customer sales order date changes, a PO date changes. I mean, there are a lot of things to your point. People are exporting information, emailing it around, even sharing it in Teams, quite frankly. But now to be able to do that in an automated fashion without manual intervention is really a game changer. And you can even combine that with Power BI alerts and things like that. Like there's some really neat stuff. Even if from our world, you know, over the past couple of years, just looking at the number of connectors and the number of templates available, both in Power Apps and Power Automate in particular, like it's just exploded. The number of things we can connect to and quite frankly, use as templates even, both in Power Apps and Power Automate for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you've got, you know, I think now we're to keep counting, it's like over 800 third-party connectors.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, whatever third parties you're using, you can connect to it for sure. And you know, if you've got some basic understanding of how to do, you know, functions in Excel, for example, you know, we're even adding in features and capability now where with AI Builder, you can talk or you can write or talk to, you know, Power Automate in kind of the search bar and say, I want to do the following. And it will start to look for those templates or even make suggestions for you. So we're trying to make it easier for people to use this technology so that they can get to rapid value much faster. And I'm, you know, I'm thinking of one example we had recently where a company was able to produce a way to do automated returns, refunds, and changing of date for delivery just by setting up some of this automation. And it gave them back thousands of hours every single month so that their people can actually spend time on more valuable work. So there's a lot of exciting stuff in this space. And I'll be honest, like having gone through your catalog and what you've got to offer, I think there's a ton of stuff that you've built that I think makes it really accessible for SMBs to actually start to take advantage of some of these AI capabilities.
Yeah, and even not only do we have, I think, 17 or 18 apps on AppSource now for Business Central, but we're actually building out a Power Automate library as well. And a couple of years back, we won an award on a Power App we did for a client. But just to segue into another subject, you know, it's very difficult to build this stuff for an on-premise deployment. So yeah. Maybe you can talk too a little bit about, you know, what Microsoft is doing to support people moving from on-prem to the cloud. Because to your point, low code, no code, et cetera, it's all built for scale. It's all built for expediency. So how does that play into what people are looking at with this on-prem to cloud sort of migration in front of them?
Yeah, I think we want to make sure that we are where our customers are, right? It's not an easy decision sometimes, and there's good reasons why people need to be where they are from an on-premise perspective, for sure. And even with some of the things we just talked about, there are ways to take things like Power Automation, take things like Power Apps, and even connect them into your legacy or on-premise system so that you can start to get some more immediate value out of them before you make the really big move. But, you know, a couple of things I'd say that we're continuing to have available for folks. One is for folks that do have their enhanced support offerings for on-premise, we're going to have a continued bridge to cloud offer. So something that effectively enables an SMB to have both on-premise and on-cloud at the same time running so that they can make that transition when they're ready, and they can go through all the right testing and everything else to kind of make that call. You know, at the same time, you know, we've worked with a number of different partners, yourself obviously included, where we're making it a little bit easier to have, I wouldn't call it a templated approach, but definitely a much more programmatic way to take what you've done on premise and move it to the cloud. And so that between, I think, kind of the offerings we put out there to make it as minimal, you know, burden of cost as possible, but then also how can we make it easier? And we know once people move to the cloud, I think people generally now get this, right? That there are trade-offs that you're going to have, but in the end, the security that you're going to get, the features and functionality, you know, staying current, and frankly, the extensibility now. Like you mentioned, for example, the app catalog and ISVs, which we'll talk about in a bit, but just the ability to go and be able to leverage work of others, like the templates that you've built, what you see in other markets working well, you can really adapt and evolve much faster, for sure.
A few weeks back, a client was having a conversation with me about on-prem to cloud, right? And I said to, you know, the emotional connection to their data was, you know, I've got a server in my office, I can hug it, I can walk to it, I can see the lights blinking. And I said, well, that, yeah, of course, for sure, that's amazing. I said, but what happens if there's a power outage? I assume you guys have a generator. And then they just looked at me. I said, well, clearly that's a problem, right? And so you talk about the cloud, and to your point, it's security, reliability, uptime, et cetera. And you know, Microsoft has that infrastructure that, quite honestly, if you stay in the on-prem world, you have to go invest in all that infrastructure, right? You know, to this day, we're still a hosting provider for Great Plains. We have backup generators and backup battery systems and multi-facilities and multiple internet connections. We pay for all that, right? So as we migrate our customers to the cloud, you know, sort of those costs tend to evaporate, right?
You know, there's maybe for another time, but if you see some of the stuff that is happening with the global data centers, like we've got data centers here in Canada, the US, on virtually every continent now. And you look at some of the things we're doing for a couple of things. One is there's performance, making sure that there's the right performance and lack of, you know, the latency is there and everything else. But even from a sustainability perspective, the thought that's going into the modularity of it, you know, we've got things that are being done now under the water, under the sea to create, you know, lower costs and give access to cloud, even in more remote parts of the world. So, you know, there's a lot there that we're doing to make sure that that becomes more accessible. And we've got Fortune 500 companies all around the world relying on it. And so I think it's tremendous when you think about all the capabilities we just talked about being accessible now to, you know, business, whether it's a shop, you know, with five people or it's, you know, 50,000 people, having that, having access to that infrastructure is incredible.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's why, you know, the cloud, I mean, particularly Business Central is growing like a weed. I mean, people are just flocking to it because of security, reliability, et cetera. So there's quite a bit of, to your point here, a lot of momentum with the product for sure.
Yeah, you know, it is still one of the fastest growing products here at Microsoft. And I mean, this is just some stats that we had back in 2019. And we're not obviously done yet in 2022. But I can tell you that the growth is still, you know, triple digit growth. We've now got well over 2,000 solutions in AppSource. And so for those who don't know, that's, think of it like the App Store, where you can go and get some of the templates and other kind of vertical applications for Business Central. But it is absolutely one of the fastest growing products for the company. And you can see from some of the things I talked about earlier, the investment in the product is tremendous. It's going to continue to be a place that we spend a lot of time in. You know, we think that as small, medium businesses are embracing the cloud and looking for some of these same innovations that larger competitors have access to, it's going to become critical that we invest in it and take it as seriously as we would any of our other products. And we're seeing companies adopt it in rapid pace because they're really getting that value from it for sure.
Yeah. And even, you know, obviously the Directions Conference, I mean, just the sheer amount of engineering power put forth towards developing the product is massive. I made an analogy in a previous webinar that, you know, if there's 700 people in Denmark working on Business Central, there's like one guy left in Fargo working on Great Plains. And yeah, I like, it's somewhat true, right? We laugh, but these are the conversations, that I get into with clients. You know, could you stay on the legacy systems? Yes, but this is where Microsoft is investing heavily in the cloud, right? So from a strategic business conversation standpoint, you know, do you really want to stay on a system that quite honestly, you know, isn't being invested in much anymore? And obviously the investment here is substantial. So
yeah, and like we're laughing and we're joking. I mean, look, we absolutely want to make sure for folks that are still on-prem, like there's great support there. No question for sure. About it. And you're bang on in everything you just said. And I think you said it really well. If you look at where all the investment is, it's going to be in the cloud capability. I mean, that's where we want to go. So we do have obviously great support options for those that need to stay on for the time being. And then we've created, I think, some good means for them to start to move and hopefully enough value for them to want to do that, you know, sooner rather than later.
Yeah. And like you mentioned, I think the next slide is just a glimpse into AppSource. I think there's well over 2,500 plus now apps out there. So that's, you know, even the ISV community has made a huge investment, as have we. You know, we now have multiple developers dedicated to nothing but developing apps for AppSource around our vertical industry solutions. So we're relentlessly focusing on that, even unrelated to our project team that has another team of developers, right? So we've dedicated cycles to just app development around our industry verticals, and it's been incredibly productive. So
yeah, I think what's brilliant about this, again, back to, you know, creating scale and giving SMBs the ability to have to take advantage of the capabilities of some of these larger ISVs developing these products. You know, there's stuff here that's very vertical specific. There's stuff here that's really horizontal in nature as well. And it just gives you ability to take what's a great product out of the box, yep, but then augment it with really cool features and capabilities. And you're right, it's well over 2,500 now and growing. Yeah. And we continue to invest. We've actually hired, even in Canada now, additional resources specifically there to go and help ISVs build on our platform and then create more awareness for customers of what's out there and available so they can get to value faster with these things.
So just switching subjects a little bit, could you maybe talk to the future, kind of what's in store for Dynamics over the coming couple of years as Microsoft continues to invest heavily in the product?
Yeah, I think just thinking of some of the themes I talked about earlier, I mean, this is a view of kind of the roadmap, I'd say, until April. And we have two kind of big beats or release cadences, spring and fall, right? So April and October. So we just kind of exited this past October with some great updates. Some of it's going to be stuff that's under the hood, and some of it's going to be stuff that you can kind of see and feel. And so you can see a variety of things here, whether it's in low code, whether it's in some of the modular apps like finance and supply chain, but also even from a collaborative perspective, what are we doing to better integrate with Teams, with Excel, making sure that the user experience in our Office applications has better connectivity back into Business Central. You know, you can see a variety of things here, like additional templates, more administration, being able to kind of take a look at the environment in one kind of central console. And so there's a variety of things that we're going to continue to invest in. And the product is actually only, from a cloud perspective, about 10 years old. And when you look at just the rapid pace, right, of development in the last couple of years, I mean, when you kind of see it on a growth chart, it's actually pretty incredible in the last, I would say, 3 years, the level of enhancements that are happening and the continued investment we're going to have across all the different modules, along with everything kind of core infrastructure and productivity wise.
Yeah, and the other thing to note too is Microsoft is incredibly open to feedback. We've got a great relationship with the engineering team in Denmark, and we can literally pinpoint things that are in the product today that we've had input on over the years. So, you know, Microsoft isn't doing this in a vacuum. They're really reaching out to partners and taking input. They're understanding customer needs, and that's where they're coming up with these release waves and the future vision for the product. So that's been incredibly effective for sure in the growth.
Oh, and I know, and listen, Andrew, you know, I think you should take more credit there because we literally have features in the product today and on the roadmap, thanks to feedback from you, based on feedback from your customers. And so I think in the most sincere way, thank you very much for everything that you do. Because I think we wouldn't have the product as quite frankly, as capable and ready for SMBs if we didn't get that feedback. And so do keep that coming. And to anyone who's watching this, reach out to Andrew. Don't be
No,
shy.
wait, don't do that. Okay.
No, but in all sincerity, thank you
No.
for that because
And
we can only make a better product that way.
no, appreciate that. And our team has been incredibly constructive with their feedback, giving Microsoft some really hard data on where the pain points are too. So I wish I could take credit for all that, but our team is just incredible at quantifying really where the impact is for both our customers and for us, like you said, sort of some under the hood type stuff as well. So it's been very good. So thank you.
No, thank you so much for having me. Like I hope for anyone who's watching, and I hope for yourself, Andrew, there was something here that you took away and learned a little bit more about. We're thrilled to see the momentum with Business Central. And you know, the more we talk to SMBs, we see a real need for them to, a real desire that they have to have access to some of the same capabilities and tools that some of the largest enterprises in the world have. And with a product like Business Central, they get a lot of the access to that same kind of technology, and it puts them on a more fair and level playing field, frankly, to compete in the marketplace. So thank you for everything that you do to help us grow this business. We're on an incredible growth path and looking forward to continuing to do that with you.
Thank you so much, Sherief, for being here. Sincerely appreciate it.
Take care, everybody.